of the family of Phil Slocum. Diane, Megan, Jason, James, and all the grandchildren, and his large extended family, we welcome you and thank you for coming. We also welcome those of you who are joining us online through our live stream from your homes to participate in today's service. Thank you for your presence as well. It means so much to Phil's family to be surrounded in this time by all of you who knew and loved Phil. And we're so impacted by his life. As Phil's family told me earlier this week when we met, Phil has said that he wants this service to be a time of celebration and rejoicing. So while we grieve and shed tears as we begin the long journey of trying to come to terms with the deep hole that has been left by Phil's passing, I know that Phil would want us to share some laughs and smiles as we share stories and memories of his life, and that's all okay. Because in the midst of both the laughter and the tears, as we celebrate a life very, very well lived, we do so with a sense of hope. The hope that comes through the resurrection promises of Jesus Christ. For Jesus himself said in John 11, I am the resurrection and the life. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who lives and believes in me will never die. We can gather today for worship with the words of the psalmist echoing in our hearts and minds from Psalm 46. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Eternal God is our dwelling place, and underneath us are God's everlasting arms. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, amid all the changes of life, you alone remain the same. We acknowledge the uncertainty of our lives on earth. We are given a mere handful of days, and our span of life seems nothing in your sight. All flesh is as grass, and all its beauty is like the flower of the field. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Our hope is in you, O God. Even in the valley of the shadow of death, you are with us. God of grace, you have given us new and living hope in Jesus Christ. We thank you that by dying, Christ destroyed the power of death, and by rising from the grave, he opened the way to eternal life. Help us to know that because he lives, we shall live also. And that neither death, nor life, nor things present, nor things to come shall ever be able to separate us from your love in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And all of God's people said, Amen. Before Phil passed, he told his family that the one song he wanted sung at his funeral was How Great Thou Art. It was a song written, and you're going to hear it in a moment. It's exciting. But it was a song written by a young Swedish pastor named Carl Boberg. who was inspired to write this poem in 1885 after he was caught in a sudden thunderstorm. The lightning flashed, the wind blew, the rain poured down. Once the storm had passed, the birds sang again. What a beautiful image of the hope we have because of who and whose we are in Christ. So let's stand and join in singing, "How Great Thou Art." You may be seated. I'd now like to welcome Chris, Cindy, and Susan to share of readings from Scripture.
One of our family's favorite verses comes from Ecclesiastes 3, in which the writer talks about time. The verses begin by looking at the two extremes of life, the bookends of your earthly existence. Everything else in between are the choices you make for how you want to live your life. The writer of Ecclesiastes tells us there is a time for every aspect of living. Hear these words of Scripture. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens, a time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and a time to gather them, a time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing, like right now. A time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and a time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time for love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace. The writer ends his verse with these words: God has made everything beautiful. And it's time.
And from John 14, do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again, and I will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid.
As I think about the last 3 years of Phil's life and how much he endured as he fought the cancer, I take a lot of comfort in the following words from Revelation 21, verse 4. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain, for the former things have passed away." And the one seated on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new." And he said, "Write this down, for these words are faithful and true."
Thank you each for those testimonies from God's eternal word. And now, as a time of sharing memories, I'd like to first welcome Rick Slocum.
Thank you. I was going to wear shorts and flip-flops in honor of Phil. Anybody out there with shorts and flip-flops? All right, permission granted. But I was told I couldn't do that. Thank you all for coming today to honor Phil. This has been a difficult time for Diane, Megan, Mark, Kelly and their spouses, and James, and all the grandchildren in the extended family. But today, and you're going to hear this theme, this is a celebration. We can be confident that Phil is at peace and in heaven. He was a strong Christian, and he believed in the resurrection. And you've heard that already, and you're going to hear it again. I get to share some reflections about him being in the Slocum family. Diane asked me to give some reflections about that. Phil was born 18 months after I was. We were close in age, so we were often treated as twins. I got a cowboy hat, he got one. I got a holster, he got a holster. I got a brown one, he got a red one, etc. We grew together and we developed a closeness. No surprise, we had the same dislikes and likes, though Phil was a very picky eater, if you're aware of that, very. So with six children in the family, we shared a lot: clothing, toys, activities, bedrooms. We were a team. We lived in a three-bedroom house. Ken, Phil, me, and baby Mary lived in one bedroom. The older two girls were in another room, my parents in the third bedroom. Phil and I shared a bed, not a king, not a queen, a three-quarter bed. Anybody know what a three-quarter bed is? We were close, okay? Living like we did, sharing and being supportive of each other was a top-down example and expectation. We taught each other how to get along and go along. No complaining. That was the goal. Phil carried that throughout life. You all know that from childhood, college, fatherhood, right through to his battle with cancer. No complaining, just work the problem. When Phil and I finished sixth and seventh grade, respectively, our dad passed away. That impacted us greatly. Kay, the oldest, left for school, college that summer, so our leading sibling was gone. And Phil and I saw Ken as Mr. Cool, junior in high school, so he was off doing that. High school was a great time for us. He was pretty good. Some people, even he, might say he excelled at sports. His junior year, he started at center, and I started at guard. We were pretty good. We had a teammate that was large. He'd be large now. I just digress a little bit. He was about 6'6", 280. Phil and I probably tipped the scales at 170. We were tough. We were smart. Phil was smart. We communicated all the time, passing people off as you do as offensive linemen. And Larry Rates, God bless him, he's a big guy. So the goal as an offensive lineman is to hold as much as you can without getting caught. And that's what we did. And after every play, Larry would say, "Coach, the Slocums are holding all the time." We go, "Not us. We're just doing our job." But at our core, from Kay down to Mary, we supported each other with encouragement. Setting an example was a huge responsibility. Phil was foundational on that. It was a Slocum family style. He went on to Carthage, and he carried that style there, where he met his future partner for life, Diane, and friends, a large cast of characters, and a lot of them are here. And they've stayed together and interacted for all that time since they graduated. It's a great group. All of them remain close today. Again, I have to digress a little bit. I have privilege. One story about his Carthage days reveal much about Phil. His approach to life, his work ethic, and the Slocum style. One of his first people he met on campus, people from Carthage know this, was Larry Olson. They played football together. They practiced, they ate dinner, and then they played cards from about 7 till 10. Is that about right, Larry? That's where the schedule diverged. Larry went back to his room. I tell this because Phil told it so well and over and over. Larry would go back to his room. We don't know what he did there, but he studied. Phil went to his room and studied for 3 or 4 hours. He was a math whiz. And their grades at the end of the semester were somewhat divergent also. Larry's dad came to visit. It was reported that Larry's dad was upset. He suggested to Larry, "You may be coming home." And he said, "Larry, I want to meet Phil Slocum to discuss why he's leading you down the path of cards and debauchery." Mr. Olson met Phil and asked him what he thought he was doing, playing cards and socializing and letting his studies go. Phil, you know Phil, being very calm, understated, said, "Mr. Olson, I don't know what you're speaking of, but I have a substantial scholarship and I have to maintain a high grade point." And I believe Phil's grade point was 3.6 or 3.7. Mr. Olson turned around, yelled Larry's name, "Larry, I want to talk to you." Phil was calm, focused, just doing what he had to do. That was Phil all through life. Thankfully, as we started the families, we lived close together, and all the cousins across all the families interacted, both sides of the family. Aster family, Joel family, everyone. Phil always was the guy that showed up, more than any of the rest of us. He showed up for nieces and nephews all the time, because it mattered. Baptisms, birthday parties, graduations, wedding showers, baby showers, sporting events, dance recital. I'm telling you, he went to all of them. From California to Wisconsin, throughout Illinois. Phil's support and commitment to his family and the larger family was unmatched by any of us. As a brother, he was my best friend. I learned a great deal from him. He was kind, calm, helpful, encouraging. Now, he could be a little prickly, I guess we would say. That's a nice word. The expression, "he didn't suffer fools easily," that's not applicable to Phil. The expression applicable to him is, "he didn't suffer wrong decisions lightly." And he was a quick study and a smart guy, and he often got to the conclusion very quickly, It was just the rest of us had to catch up to where he had already gotten. So I could go on and on, 69 years plus, there's lots of stories. But in the past few weeks, he continued to go to grandchildren events, visit with family and friends, Zoom with his siblings, never complaining, always asking how everybody else was, bringing that Slocum style to the fore. But this is important. The essential message to remember from this celebration of Phil's life is that he is truly a part of each of us. He will continue to be so forever. He is in our souls and our hearts, in our bones. He continues to live through each of us, and particularly through Diane, Megan, Mark, Kelly, James, grandchildren, spouses, extended family, nieces, and nephews. Share your favorite stories of Phil. Laugh and enjoy them, because Phil is doing the same.
Thank you, Rick. And now, welcome Mark
to share a time of memories as well.
Good job, Uncle Rick. Must have been so easy. I don't think I've been up here since like confirmation, freshman year. Finally have everyone's attention. All right, well, I'm Mark Slocum, Phil's oldest son, up here to share on behalf of his four kids, Megan, myself, Kelly, James, Megan's husband, Jason, my wife, Liz, Kelly's husband, Todd, Grandpa's nine grandkids, Grayson, Jackson, Lucas, Ava, Hayes, Ollie, Reed, Vivian, baby Maeve. As for my mom, she wrote her own letter, which I'm sure is beautiful, perfectly worded, captures all that was great about our dad. Good luck reading that one, Todd. So how do we say goodbye to our dad? How do we honor him? How do we verbalize how much we love him? How do we do justice to the impact that he made on everyone's lives that he entered? What would Phil Slocum do? He would show up, as he always did. For everyone, not just us. He showed up somehow for everyone in this room. He showed up for the hundreds of people yesterday that stood in line for 2 hours just to pay their respects and see him. He showed up for people he didn't know. He showed up for people that needed his help. He showed up to celebrate. He showed up to support. He showed up without being asked. The last few years, it could have been 90 degrees. And my dad was still wrapped up in a blanket and cold. Yet it could be cold, windy, rainy, but that would not keep him from showing up at his grandkids' games. Because that's what he did. Phil Slocum lived to show up. And we want to thank everyone that showed up for my dad, my mom, and all of us over the last 3 years. Dad was so many things to so many people. He was Dad, Hunter, as my mom and him called each other, Uncle Phil, Don Felipe, Coach Phil, brother, friend, coworker, for 42 years and countless other relationships he valued. Dad had 4 kids, 2 son-in-laws, 1 daughter-in-law, 20 nieces and nephews, 9 grandkids, and he made the time to have a personal relationship with every single one of them. To Dad, family was it. And if you weren't in the family, you better believe he made you feel like you were. We especially want to thank our mom. Who showed up in ways I can't imagine over the last 3 years. Dad was so proud of his nurse, Diane. Although, it should be noted, Dad was not the best patient all the time. Aunt Sue knows what I'm talking about. Mom, thank you from all of us. You set the tone from the beginning that we would do this together, with love, with faith, with compassion, with patience. The strength it took to do what you did for Dad, but then acknowledge openly with us your fears, your grief, your doubt, your regrets, and your anger. You exemplified unconditional love every day of this journey. And it was an impossible journey. That is why you are the Queen Mother. That's right. We love you, we thank you, we respect you, and we will be with you as we begin this next journey together. So this past week, we showed up and did what few can do better than Phil Slocum. We told stories. To remember our dad, yeah, he could tell a story. He took a few liberties. Stories evolved a little bit over time, but that's the sign of a good storyteller, I think. So I'll give one story, try to channel my best inner Phil, and for the college guys here, whether this is how it played out or not, this is how his kids heard it, and we loved hearing it the first time and the 150th time. So I don't know who this was, if they're sitting in this room or not, but Dad told the story as one of the guys on the dorm went home too often. He was always gone on the weekends, so they were going to kind of mess with him, and they decided before he got back, they were going to take his entire room and set it up outside. So he came home to this, and my dad was in the process of taking his mattress and throwing it out the window when the guy came back. And, Phil, what are you doing? He goes, come over here, help me. And the guy's like, all right. He comes up and he's like, oh man, help me. And he goes, whose is this? And he goes, yours. I don't know if it's true or not, but just a great, that was Dad. I mean, he could tell a story out of anything, and he loved telling stories, especially the college ones. A lot of them, if they got inappropriate or anything, would trail off in a humana, 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 and he wouldn't really finish it, and, you know, he'd make some noises and hand gestures. But behind every story was a common theme or a lesson. His stories were representative of how he lived his life. He surrounded himself with great people, great friends, great family. He was as loyal as they come, and he put in the work to keep nurturing all those relationships and continually create new memories. So, Dad, he was the most authentic person you'll ever meet and I've ever met. I don't think he even knew what peer pressure felt like. He was confident, but not arrogant. He was trustworthy. He was highly driven, but also incredibly content and appreciative for what he had. He knew who he was. That confidence and self-acceptance was probably what made people so comfortable around him. You never felt like Phil was trying to get anything from you. One of his gifts was just being present with whomever he was with, and he could talk to anyone, and people loved talking to him. Our family received countless messages, everyone in this room the past week, just stating what Dad meant to them. The most common theme was how much people loved their conversations with him. When you spoke to our dad, he gave you his full attention. He genuinely cared what you had to say. If you came to him with a problem, he would listen, but he'd also help you work through it and often push you a little bit. One of his longtime coworkers yesterday said, "Phil was tough, but fair." I think that's pretty apt for him. But he did what he could do to help people get the most out of themselves. He really believed in people. That man could also find something in common with anyone, anywhere, anytime, which was probably because he was just such a great listener. And he taught us all a lot. I think it was Aunt Rhonda said to my cousin Dave this week, that if you aren't learning something from Uncle Phil every time you talk with him, then you aren't paying attention. I felt that way my whole life. I'm gonna miss talking to him. Dad, from all of us, thank you for loving being our dad. We loved being the kids. The kids loved being your grandkids. And our spouses loved having you as their father-in-law. And your nieces and nephews loved Uncle Phil. We have loved and been loved well. We will miss you, and we love you.
Thank you, Mark. And I'd like to welcome Todd Phillips to share a letter from Diane.
Good afternoon. Very honored to share this letter from Phil, to Phil from Diane. I didn't know I had to follow two slocums here, so this is, you know, not an enviable position. So Phil's, Diane's letter. "I can't believe I'm writing this letter, Philip Myron. I thought we would have more time, but I guess God knew it was your time for you to go. And while my heart is broken that I have lost my best friend for the last 45 some years, I am comforted by knowing after 3 years of enduring everything this terrible cancer threw at you, you are finally at peace, and that gives my heart some peace. Phil, as I sit here and think about your life, I think about one of my favorite poems written by Linda Ellis, where the author about how when your life is over, everything you did will be represented by a single dash between two dates. The question is, what will that dash mean for the people that have known and loved you? Author Mac Anderson expands on Ellis's poem with a book called The Dash, Making a Difference with Your Life from Beginning to End. Anderson talks about how the poem motivates us to make certain choices in our life. Choices to ignore the calls of selfishness and instead reach out to others using our God-given abilities to brighten their days and lighten their loads. Phil, that's exactly what you did. You weren't perfect, and God knows we had our ups and downs like every married couple. But honestly, Slocum, you lived your dash so very, very well. I will be grateful for the rest of my life that you chose me to live out your dash with you. When I look back on our life together, there are three things that I believe cemented our relationship. The first was your unending love and commitment to family. from the first time you took me home to Winnebago to meet your five wonderful siblings and mom. I knew this was a family I wanted to be a part of, and my family felt the same way about you. We've been beyond blessed to be a part of this large, fun-loving group of people who have all showed up in the last few years to love on and support you, Phil. Family meant everything to you, and they knew it. The second thing I loved about our years together were the lifelong friendships you made throughout your life. I asked a few of those friends to send me a few thoughts of what you meant to them. The first note is a collaboration written by Doug Perks on behalf of he and four of your lifelong Winnebago high school friends, Max Storm, Craig Dummer, John Schmidt, Chuck Fricky. There are so many stories and memories they could tell about their friendships that have lasted some 50 years now. But the favorite story that Phil loved to tell was about the canoe trip they all took the summer of August 1969. Doug writes, "The six of us took off in Doug Perks' family 27-foot green Dodge motorhome and headed to northern Wisconsin. We named our two canoes the Green Avenger and the Silver Ritz, and ended up racing the canoes down the rapids of the Brule and St. Croix rivers. It seemed like Phil's canoe, the Green Avenger, always won. After a few days, we became bored with the scenery and decided to drive down to the Wisconsin State Fair, where we spent a fun-filled day parked in the middle of the Midway in the motorhome. While we were there, we heard that the astronauts who had just completed the first landing on the moon were headed to Miggs Field in Chicago. After some mutually inspired discussions, we decided to drive to Chicago for the parade. The next day we headed south and we pulled into Miggs Field, and as we pulled into Miggs Field, we were directed to go out onto the airport tarmac. Our motorhome happened to look very similar to one that was part of the Illinois Bell Telephone Telecommunication Services. They happened to be covering the rally. So through security guards, the security guards' confusion and what we like to think was our cunning expertise, we ended up several hundred feet from the helicopters carrying Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. We watched them as they got off the helicopters, waving to thousands of enthusiastic spectators and hopping into their open-top limousines for a ticker tape parade down State Street. As they started to pull away to go to the parade route, we revved up the engines of our motorhome. We told Phil and the guys to ride on top of the motorhome and pretend to be newscasters. They were so convincing that we were waved forward and became part of the parade. There we were, five Winnebago High School guys on top of a motorhome as part of the largest ever ticker tape parade Chicago has hosted. For at least 10 blocks, we fooled the security guards into thinking we were part of the news teams. And our picture even made it the cover of the August 1969 edition of Newsweek. Finally, deciding maybe we better get out of there before we got in trouble, we made our way off to a side alley where we watched the rest of the parade and then headed home, chuckling to ourselves the whole way at the big heist we had just pulled off. When we got home, my mom and dad came out to welcome and greet the six of us. My mother asked, "Where have you been?" I said, "Up north canoeing. Why do you ask?" Clearly not believing me, she grabbed Phil and said, "Phil, where have you been?" In classic Phil style, Phil Slocum style, he said, "Mrs. Perks, I cannot tell a lie. We have been in Chicago in the astronaut parade." My mom paused and said, "Yeah, I know. I saw you on TV." That was one of the most fun memories of our high school years. And a few years back, the six of us got together and spent a long weekend piloting a riverboat down the Mississippi, reminiscing and creating new memories. In closing, I can only say that we have all had blessed lives knowing Phil through these years. Phil was a natural-born leader. He cared about his friends. He was compassionate and competitive and always helpful. He did everything right and by the book. He stayed in touch with all five of us to the end. May he continue his joyous journey in the hands of our good Lord. God bless his soul and good memories. From your fraternity brother and colleague at CBOE, John Johnston, Phil made two life-altering decisions some 45 to 50 years ago that would have unbelievable long-term effects. The first decision came in 1970 when he enrolled at Carthage College and joined the Tau Sigma Phi fraternity. This resulted in 51 years of some of the best friendships a person could hope to have in his life. The bond that has been established with his fraternity brothers continues to this day. The years at Carthage, the golf trips to Arizona and Florida with fraternity brothers, and for the most part of the last 25 years or so, the big chill reunions in northern Wisconsin with fraternity brothers and wives were all events that Phil loved. The chance to be with his friends and just enjoy life, it meant a lot to his friends that Phil was there, and I know it meant a lot to him that he was able to be there also. The second life-altering decision came in the spring of 1975. He went to work for CBOE. Obviously, unbeknownst to him at the time, this would be the start of a 42-year career in the financial industry at CBOE. He thrived in the business. He moved up in the organization, succeeded at what he did, and loved working at CBOE. And although he could be tough at times, and some may say stubborn, he was respected and well-liked. And just as he did at the fraternity, he developed some wonderful personal relationships over the years that continued even after retirement. And from your Wheaton friends, Scott Iliff, Bob Ballinger, and Bill Ulrich, you probably know that Phil liked to tell stories. Phil told many on the way to his second favorite lake house in Apple Canyon. As we passed his boyhood home of Winnebago, memories could come flooding back in stories about friends and farm families growing up. When approaching Apple Canyon after a round of golf, he might even decide, rather than pass the farm, that he would take the Suburban up a cow path halfway into the field. We were always glad that we never had to explain ourselves to the resident farmer. But then Phil would have just talked his way out of it. When Phil wasn't playing classic rock trivia with his brother-in-law, Bill, they were usually arguing about politics and economic policy. Can't say Bill ever changed his mind, but Phil listened to what Bill said and responded with mostly fact-based arguments before telling Bill he was wrong. Last spring, Phil played his last round of golf at Apple Canyon with Bob, Bill, and Scott. He played great and came in and ordered his favorite drink, the Woodbine Breeze. He got quite emotional as he said he never thought he could ever play golf that well again, and they all cried. Phil had many stories, but at other times he was the story. After a certain horse race went wrong at the ranch, Phil found himself with his three wives, Diane, Shelley, and Chris, in a Ludington, Michigan hospital in the emergency room with a broken femur. Admitting a pain level of only 4 caused an uproar among the wives, who later stuck funny temporary tattoos on him while he was still coming out of anesthesia from surgery to put a 12-inch rod into his leg. We realized then how close we came to losing him and how frightened we were. When asked by a friend who was getting a retirement gift for Phil, which was an engraved rock, what one word do you think of when you think of Phil? Many wonderful words rushed forward, but integrity was the first. You could count on this man to be there for his family and friends and those in need. But as you watched Phil lead his life, you knew what was at the center of his story, the love he had for his best friend, Diane, and their wonderful family, anchored in the greatest story and love of all, Jesus Christ. Phil was a true rock for us all. His many stories are our stories. We love you, Phil. Now back to Diane's part. Phil, as your wife, I can only say that you are the strongest person I have ever known in my life. From your strong faith in God, to your strong work ethic, to being such a strong husband, father, brother, brother-in-law, uncle, son, colleague, friend, and follower of Jesus. Throughout your whole life, God gave you the strength to just be there time and time again for people who needed a hand. And we knew we could always count on Phil Slocum to show up and do what needed to be done. I will always be in awe of the incredible strength you showed these last few years as you endured so many medical challenges and came to terms with knowing Grandpa would not be around to watch his 9 beloved grandchildren grow up. It broke your heart, but Phil, your strength gave me strength, and it's the legacy you have given to your 4 children and their families. That legacy has been my greatest gift as Megan, Jason, Mark and Liz, Kelly and Todd, James, and all the grandchildren, as well as our wonderful extended family, have shown up time and time again over these last few years to do whatever it took, often at great cost to themselves and their own families, to support you and I in this journey. As Kelly said to me not long ago, Mom, God gave our family this story to write, and we're going to keep writing it the best way we know how. And they did, in ways that I know made you so proud and grateful. We were with you to the very end, crying and laughing all at the same time, as we ushered you with all the love we had inside us to a new and better tomorrow. Phil, the dash you lived now lives inside each of us, and I promise you that your story of courage and selflessness and giving back to the world and loving life and loving unconditionally and showing up, what you called the good stuff, will be part of all the stories God will continue to write in each and every one of us who knew and loved my Philip Myron Slocum. Thank you, hubby, for everything. You will never be forgotten. I love you, Diane.
Imagine what it will be like when I walk by your side. I can only imagine what my eyes will see when your face is before me. I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine when that day comes and I find myself standing in the sun. Only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship. Surrounded by your glory, what will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus, or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence, or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? Will I only imagine? I can only imagine. Surrounded by your glory, What will my heart feel? Will I dance for you, Jesus? Or in awe of you be still? Will I stand in your presence? Or to my knees will I fall? Will I sing hallelujah? Will I be able to speak it all? Only imagine. Yeah, I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. I can only imagine. Yeah, yeah. I can only imagine. Only imagine when all I will do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
Thank you, Doug and Paul. Philip Melanchthon was born February 16th, 1497. He was a German Lutheran reformer, the first systematic theologian of the Protestant Reformation. He was an intellectual leader of the Lutheran Reformation, an influential designer of educational systems. He actually stands next to Martin Luther, John Calvin, as reformer, theologian, and molder of Protestantism. Other than not being Presbyterian, his resume sounds a lot like a Phil that I knew. That was Phil. And it sounds a lot like a Phil that I knew because of how much he loved this church. As a member of First Presbyterian Church of Wheaton for over 30 years, serving as elder in many different ministry areas, he shared his financial acumen as chair of the church investment committee, among others. He was the kind of saint that made me want to be the best pastor that I could be. He also loved the church. If Diane was in Elmhurst, he was there. If the kids were in Glen Ellen, he was there. He was everywhere, even in the Chicago Presbytery. And not everybody wants to go to Presbytery, but Phil did. He was easily the most enthusiastic person I knew about the ministry of the Presbytery. But that was Phil. He was even responding to church emails in Zoom meetings from his very hospital bed. With his life, as Mark said earlier, he taught people how to show up for what was important to them, and his faith was at the top of the list. When it came to expressing his faith, generosity, and what he believed went hand in hand. If there were a more generous soul, we will still be looking day after day. A year ago, Phil graciously agreed to film his generosity story for our fall stewardship campaign, a testimony about why he gave to this congregation. He shed tears as he spoke of the special privilege of being a blessing, of being incredibly generous, of joyfully giving away as much as he could, knowing he wouldn't be taking it with him. If you read Phil's obituary, you know that he had, as we've heard today, a habit of making lifelong friends. So it doesn't surprise me now to know that in the very first week after becoming pastor here at First Press, where was I? I was invited to Phil and Diane's home, along with several other church friends, for dinner. He did genuinely love people. And he had a genuine acceptance for everyone. Black, white, gay, straight, Presbyterian, Pentecostal. He could talk to everyone, and that was Phil. You might not, in fact, even know that Phil was sick. He wasn't a complainer. He was an inspiration to the cancer support group here at the church. In fact, as you know, he was a coach, and having played football, he endured his battle with cancer to the very end. The fourth quarter, the final play. Even at his bedside, the night before he died, he was not giving up without a fight. As I read Psalm 23, even in the valley of the shadow of death, I could see his will to live at work. And as we heard from Ecclesiastes 3, there's a time for everything, a season for everything. And the truth is, Phil never took a season off. He worked hard in business for so many decades, and just after starting his retirement, when most people would be slowing down, his next chapter included working hard to keep a terrible disease at bay. He was faithful to the end, and yes, even stubborn, but that was Phil. Phil loved Diane and his family so deeply, there's nothing he wouldn't do for them. And that was just obvious to all of us. In the New Testament, there's a Greek word pronounced storge, and it's the term in the Bible for a word that describes familial love, family love, the affectionate bond that develops naturally between parents and children, brothers and sisters. It was this kind of love that we saw expressed in Phil's life for his family. He fulfilled what Romans 12:10 says, be devoted to one another in love. Honor one another above yourselves. That was Phil. His legacy will be found in the lives of his children and grandchildren until the time comes. He'll be waiting on that heavenly bench for you. Today we affirm the words of John chapter 14, that Jesus has indeed gone on to prepare a place for us. And for all who place their trust in him. So no matter how Phil's passing may be affecting you in the tears and in the laughter, know that we have a Savior who knows us intimately and who wants to be known not just for a day, but for all eternity. And now, Phil has gone ahead of us as well. On the sidelines of heaven, the saints are lining up to welcome him. It is a kickoff Sunday in heaven. Can you picture it? The angels are cheering and singing the refrain, good stuff, encapsulating the words of Jesus, well done, good and faithful servant. Well done. Amen.
times in our lives, we all have pain, we all have sorrow. But if we are wise, we know that there's always tomorrow. Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. So please swallow your pride if I have faith that you need to borrow. For no one can fill those of your needs that you won't let show.
Just call on me, brother, when you need a hand. We all need somebody to lean on. I just might have a problem that you'll understand. We all need somebody to lean on.
Lean on me when you're not strong, and I'll be your friend. I'll help you carry on, for it won't be long till I'm gonna need somebody to lean on. Just call on your brother when you need a hand.
We all need somebody to lean on.
I just might have a problem that you'll understand.
We all need somebody to lean on.
If there is a load that you have to bear that you can't carry, I'm right up the road and I'll share your load. If you just call me,
call me.
If you need a friend,
call me.
She says, call
me.
We say, call
me. We all need somebody to lean on.
Let's now lean upon the Lord in prayer. Would you pray with me? Eternal God, before whom all generations rise and pass, we praise you for all your servants who, having lived life in faith, now live eternally with you. Especially we thank you for your servant, Phil Slocum, whose baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave him that kindled in him the love for your dear name and enabled him to serve you faithfully. We pray that his memory may live long among us and be a source of strength for us. We pray that your grace and presence will be with all those who loved Phil and who will miss him the most. Especially we pray for Diane, Megan, Jason, Mark, Liz, Kelly, Todd, James, and his 9 grandchildren, all extended family, and for all who gather here and at home, who are watching and remembering and celebrating his life today. In our sorrow, make us strong to commit ourselves and those we love to your unfailing care. In our perplexity, help us to trust where we cannot understand. In our loneliness, may we remember Phil in love, sustained by all the wonderful memories he's given us. trusting him to your keeping until the day we are reunited together in the life to come. We thank you that fulfilled death is past and pain is ended, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared in your heavenly kingdom. And now, with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Diane shared with me that the last movie she and Phil watched on Netflix the week before he passed was a movie called Greater. It was a story of Brandon Bolesworth, who had always dreamed of playing for the Arkansas Razorbacks, but was considered too short and too fat to play Division I. Undeterred, Brandon took a big risk and walked on. Written off by all the coaches and fellow teammates, Brandon defied all odds to become one of the most respected players in the history of the program, changing the lives of all he touched. 11 days before being drafted into the NFL, Brandon was tragically killed in a car accident. The story is told through the eyes of his older brother, who struggled with his faith at the loss of his brother. The movie ends with the brother making peace with God and coming into his brother's worship service to sing the final song, I'll Fly Away. Diane tells me that as she and Phil watched, they both just started singing together because they loved the song and they loved the story. And remembering that moment after Phil was gone, Diane said that she firmly believed that God grabbed hold of Phil in the last moments in this life and simply said, Come on, Phil. Let's get out of here. It's time. Let's fly away to a better place. With joy and gratitude, I invite us all to stand and sing our closing song, I'll Fly Away.
Bye.
by and by, I'll fly away.
After the blessing, I invite the pallbearers forward as we escort the casket out. And now into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Phil. Acknowledge him, we humbly pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. And now for those of us who remain on this side of eternity, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen.